five. There'll be a couple of little changes today, but nothing dramatic. Well, good morning, everyone. We're celebrating the fourth Sunday of Easter. It is known as Good Shepherd Sunday and Vocations Sunday. And we'll be praying for vocations later on in the Mass. And I will be renewing my commitment to the parishioners later on during the Mass and they to me at the same time. So our opening hymn is the number 365, Shepherd of Souls. Saved, and in the name of Jesus Christ, crucified but risen from the dead. May the risen Lord Jesus be with you always.
And also with you.
We expect of people in change of others, especially in tasks of leadership and service, that they are dedicated to those who rely on them. Doctors, social workers, priests, ministers, rabbis, and the list could go on. For those who are Christians, the model is no other than Jesus, the Good Shepherd. He had a heart for people and was willing to go as far as laying down his own life for them. All those responsible for others should be like him, not functionaries, not people who just do their job, but whether lay or ordained, pastors that is, literally shepherds, shepherds with a heart, totally dedicated, even at great cost to themselves sometimes. And let us not forget that we are all entrusted with and to one another. And may Jesus among us inspire and guide us. Let us pray to our Good Shepherd to forgive us. The shepherd looks for the lost sheep and does not condemn it. We rely on Jesus' loving mercy. Jesus, our Good Shepherd, you lay down your life for your sheep, for all the people you came to save. God have mercy. Jesus Christ, our Good Shepherd, you know your sheep, all your people, and those who accept you and know you. Christ have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Jesus Christ, our Good Shepherd, you still have other sheep who are outside, and you want to bring them back to the flock. God, have mercy. Have mercy on us, Abba. Seek us out and bring us all the peace of your forgiveness and love, and lead us to everlasting life. And in your missalettes, the music side, if you want to go to 878, because somebody asked me, where's the Gloria? That's what it is. But it's the old words. Let us pray. God of many names, by his own free will, Jesus gave his life for us, that we might live and be saved. Give us the courage to listen to his voice and to follow him on the way to you. May we also reflect the love he has shown us by caring for one another with the same self-forgetting kindness he has shown to us. We ask you this in the name of Jesus, our brother.
The first reading is a reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, spoke up. Leaders of the people, elders, if we must answer today for a good deed done to a person who is unable to walk, and explain how this person has been made whole, then you and all the people of Israel must realize that it was done in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified and whom God raised from the dead. In the power of that name, this person stands before you perfectly sound. This Jesus is a stone rejected by the builders that has become the cornerstone. There is no salvation in anyone else, for there is no other name under heaven given to the human race by which we must be saved. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Our second reading today is from the first letter of John. See what love Abba God has lavished on us in letting us be called God's children. Yet that, in fact, is what we are. The reason the world does not recognize us is that it never recognized God. My dear friends, now we are God's children. But it has not been revealed what we are to become in the future. We know that when it comes to light, we will be like God, for we will see God as God really is. And this, too, is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, God.
Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. A good shepherd would die for the sheep. The hired hand, who is neither a shepherd nor owner of the sheep, catches sight of the wolf coming and runs away, leaving the sheep to be scattered or snatched by the wolf. This is because the hired hand works only for pay and has really no concern for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me, in the same way Abba God knows me, and I know God. And for these sheep I will lay down my life. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must lead them too, and they will hear my voice. And then there will be one flock, one shepherd. This is why Abba God loves me, because I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me. I lay it down freely. I have power to lay it down, and I have the power to take it up again. This command I receive, O my God. The good news of our salvation.
Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ.
As I said in the beginning, this is Good Shepherd Sunday, and you can see why by the gospel. In the readings today, we see Jesus described as the cornerstone on where the church is built. Now, years ago when they built stuff, the cornerstone was the most important stone. Today, with all the architectural things that have happened, and I've seen where they have the whole building built and then they have the cornerstone and they have a dedication, or they might put stuff in the cornerstone and then they stick it into the building. You know, so it's not like it was at that time. I like to change it a little bit and call them the keystone. Because still, when you have an archway, and again, I feel like I'm teaching science to my fifth graders, when you have the archway, that stone right up here, that's the keystone. That's what Pennsylvania is all for, is the keystone state. And if you take that keystone out, the archway will collapse. So I'm kind of making it a little more the keystone. Jesus is the keystone of the church. And through our baptism, so are we. We are the keystones. That's why you hear me talk about us as we are the ambassadors. We are the keystones for our faith. To bring it out there to people. And in the gospel, you see Jesus get a little cynical with the hired hand. You know, the wolf is coming. He doesn't give a dang. That's not his sheep. He sees the wolf coming. He's hightailing it out. You're on your own, sheep. Bye! You know, type thing. Because he doesn't own them. He doesn't have a vested interest in them. Where Jesus is the true shepherd and he has a vested interest in every single one of the sheep. That's us. Whether he didn't say, I only have an interest on my sheep or those who follow me only. He made reference to those that are not out there. I still have other sheep. And that's all those who believe in him and don't believe in him. And believe in him in different ways. Now that's the cool part. You know, true, the church has messed up over its 2,000 years. You just need to watch CNN's series on the Pope, the most powerful man on earth, which is a good series if you haven't seen it. Get it on demand. It's awesome. Learn how he had 3 popes at one time. A young one that was 19 and he left, came back. You know, it's amazing. And this is the same church that's here today. You know, if that isn't faith in the shepherd watching, I don't know what's what. You know, in the readings of Easter, we see the beginnings of the church, with the Acts of the Apostles. Did the apostles know what they were doing? They had no clue. They were doing it as we would say on a wing and a prayer. You know, but they tried. They tried to follow what Jesus was saying. You see, Peter's, making a big thing about healing a crippled man, causing commotion. You know, he doesn't take credit for it. He said, I do it through the power of Jesus. There's a lot of things we do that we might amaze ourselves, or things coming into our lives all of a sudden. That's through the power of Jesus. As you being his ambassador. You know, you might hit Sandy, a client that you thought was like a brick wall. And all of a sudden, it's like an aha moment. That's Jesus working through you to get through that.
Especially
a few of those. You know? Oh, I thought that as an educator. You know, you get somebody on the phone. Because you're being a real pill. And just the way you're acting with them, you calm them down. Well, that's Jesus working through you, or that guest at Disney Springs that's, you know, one of those, I paid enough money, you're going to have fun. You know, I've seen a lot of that at Disney. And you just, you know, diffuse that by something you say or do or, you know, It's amazing how Jesus works through us. As you'll hear me say in a few weeks, the Holy Spirit came like a Disney firework on Pentecost. But since that time, the Holy Spirit works through us like a breath of wind. Very simple breeze. No more big ta-ta. That's the way the good shepherd is. A shepherd is very subtle. A shepherd in Christ's time wasn't one of the, you know, top jobs where you get recognition and all of that. It was very simple. That's what Jesus is telling us, is to be simple. Keep to the tenets he gave us, to the cliff notes that he gave us on how to live life and try the best we can, knowing that we're going to mess up. That's the important part. He, the shepherd, knows that we're going to mess up. But he's right there. Look how many images we see in art of Jesus, the shepherd. When I don't know how many of you, I say this all the time, I don't know how many of you actually see the website, but every week on the front page, I change the picture to go with the readings. And I take time picking out what picture. Sometimes I want a modernistic looking one, or an old-fashioned classic, or depending on what it is. In looking for this week's, all the pictures I saw of Jesus, the Good Shepherd, was a nice looking Jesus, a nice Caucasian looking Jesus, you know, that would be on the front page of GQ magazine, holding a sheep over his shoulders.
Yeah.
But every single sheep was black. I did not find a picture with him holding a white sheep. And I thought about it for a minute. And looking over the gospel, took that as the ones that haven't been to the flock yet. But I'm still there to pick you up. And to give you help, to give you love, give you unconditional love and guidance. That to me said a lot. And that's where we stand today. We have to be those shepherds that go out in this world and take care of the sheep. Because the sheep have no guidance today. They really don't. We're the ones that are going to have to be the shepherds with the voice and with the guidance. Last Sunday, when we left here and we were going to the car, I get outside and I see Graham and John and Marion. They're talking to this couple who saw our ad in the Orlando Center. The woman wasn't from here. The gentleman, I think, was in Winter Park. But they were asking questions about the church here. And her name was Dorothy. And that's what even struck her more, because she never thought there was a St. Dorothy. And she was Catholic. You know, and so she was asking. And they were answering the questions. They were doing a great job explaining. And I said to them afterwards, you know what you just did? You just brought it out there to her. You didn't realize it, but that's what you did. You know, and that's the Holy Spirit working through the three of them in a very subtle way.
Where's Mary?
Mary's, she hurt her shoulder, so she's not here. You know, so we have to continue. It's going to be tough. There's going to be times when people are going to make fun of you, they'll ridicule you, they might call you holy roller, whatever. But that's part of it. You know, look what Jesus went through. And if we're true followers of him, well, yeah, we're going to suffer too, whatever it might be for our day. You know, yesterday, I don't know how many of you did, but I had the opportunity to watch Barbara Bush's funeral, which was fantastic. And you know Chocolate Sean that comes to Mass now and then. He was watching it with me. And I was doing texting. I was like the commentator you hear on TV. I was texting. And now you see the casket come down the aisle with a sheet over it. That symbolizes baptism. giving them a blow by blow. Many things about the funeral were so beautiful, very simple. Did you know that she planned it several days before her death with her pastor? I didn't even realize she was Episcopalian. You know, she had been going to St. Martin's for over 50 years. The pastor would go up and kind of pour over and all that. So she planned it herself. Amazing. And something Jeb said really struck me. Because he said he was with his mom, and he asked, Soma, are you afraid to die? You know, she knew she was gone. And the answer back that he gave her, I mean, she gave him, was remarkable. She goes, Jeb, I know Jesus is my Savior. So I'm not afraid. I'm afraid leaving your dad, but I know I'm going to be in a better place. That was a beautiful statement of faith. And in 2015, not that long ago, so she would have been what, 90, was when she was finally confirmed. She received the sacrament of confirmation. She had asked for that, but she had never received that sacrament. Again, an outstanding model of the faith, you know, to her kids. I don't know if you know, but Jeb converted from Episcopalian to Catholic. That was there, you know, and it was funny because another quick thing, it's kind of like Jesus the shepherd playing jokes with the sheep. She died Saturday, if I'm not mistaken, correct? Last Saturday? The day before, she was with George. She goes upstairs, you know, she said, I'm going to be tired, I want to go to bed. And so she goes upstairs, and they waited a little bit, and the daughter said to the pastor of the church, would you go up and check on Mom?
Sure.
So he goes upstairs and he checks on Mom, says who he is, and she yells out the door, I'm fine, I'm not going to expire yet. And tell George I love him. Those are her words. I used that in this talk yesterday. Again, the unconditional love right there. And one thing they said that people don't know wasn't in the news was because another reporter was talking to her father. And as she was talking to her father, the power went out in Houston. During that power outage was when Robert died. And after she died, the lights went out. You know, you can read into it what you want, just a coincidence or whatever. But again, it could be the Good Shepherd having a little fun with everyone. So again, yesterday we saw an outstanding woman who wasn't afraid to speak out when it was tough, when she got help hard, you know, but always trying to be an example of the gospel. So we see all of this around us. We see the kids that are protesting. They're doing the gospel. There's so much signs. We have to be part of those signs if we're truly going to follow the Good Shepherd. We have to be the ones with the sheep on our shoulders, bringing them back to where they need to be. So I give you three suggestions on how to do it. And I'm going to call them the three W's. The first is the way we treat people. We are the ambassadors of Christ. And so our manner, our way of holding ourselves should be full of dignity, generosity, openness, elegance, and joy. Remember how we started Easter? It's joyful. How much joy do we have? How many people do we see out there that look like they suck the lemon? There's no smiles, there's no more joy. If we let God's grace work in our hearts, it's going to shine through our eyes. It's going to shine through our words. It's going to shine through our gestures. We're going to become living advertisements for the Good Shepherd. People will say, why are you always happy? Why aren't you happy? You know? Second is our work. Second, no. Whatever we do in life, we as followers of Christ should stand out for our responsibility, dependability, and commitment to excellence. We have to, because we're children of God. We're the ambassadors of the Creator of the universe. How could we ever let sloppiness, laziness, and indifference contaminate our daily activities? That's not us. No one that I see in front of me. Oh, he's not there. And lastly, the third W is by our words. You know, you heard Peter in today's first reading. We should always be ready to use our words to spread the truth, hope, and encouragement, to light or feed the fire of faith in the hearts of those around us. Notice I didn't say sugarcoat. I didn't say be politically correct. Sometimes the truth is hard to swallow, but we have to do it. You know, we shouldn't be involved with gossip, you know, tattletaling, or what they used to call it back in my day, or criticism. You know, I used to get very upset at Disney because they would love to criticize in my department. And I used to say a very biting line to the leadership. They didn't like it, but they couldn't get me on it. I would point to my badge and say, that says Jim, not Jesus Christ, so I am going to make mistakes. You know, like I said, the truth is hot sometimes. They never could get me on it. And I would remind them, my boss gets you for eternity. Never lose sight of the Eucharist. That's why we're here reading. Is that. And then, how does this fit in vocations? Well, as I said, this is Vocation Sunday. And everybody thinks that means, as the way it was taught to us, kind of, growing up, was, we're going to pray for more priests and nuns. Yeah, we're going to pray for more, you know, shepherds in the church, be it male, female. But also, all of us have a vocation, whether you're clergy, non-clergy, whatever. I hate the label. I hate clergy, lady. You know, it makes us like us, them. It goes back to the days of the old church when you had the altar rail that separated us. Clergy from the laity. No, we're all in this together. Everybody has different roles. Again, I hate to use Disney, but since we're here in Orlando, you know, what else do I have? If we're watching, if we're at the park, and let's say we're watching the show at the castle, stage in front of the castle, which I'm sure all of you are familiar with, you might been there, not been there. Well, how do they put on that show? It takes a lot of people. Costuming, the actors, lighting, sound, you know, and it goes on and on. Same thing with us being ambassadors of Christ. Every ambassador has a different job. So those are all vocations. Those are all vocations. And you can change your vocations during your life as God wants to use you. And it's up to us to say, got you covered. You want me to change? I did education. I wanted priesthood. My priesthood role didn't take a straight path by any means in the imagination. It was so windy, it was like going up to one of the roads in Colorado. You know? But I was used. Think of yourself, how you have been used in different venues, and how you will continue the change. How God will give you new vocations. that you don't even realize. Now, John, I'm going to pick on you. By your moving, you've started a brand new vocation. You're still working at Disney, but now you have another person in your life, your roommate. The two of you were put together for a reason. You're going to influence him, he's going to influence you. And from that, you're going to spread it. Or you might meet somebody at the pool and start up a conversation and bringing it out there. Jackie, through your, you know, going doing the film festival, you had a lot of people. You were doing a different vocation. The people you meet at the thrift store. I haven't said anything. That's up to you. You know, Tommy, you and Sandy are like, you know, the team. You affect so many people. Some you know, some you can see, some you'll never know how you affect them. You know? That's all your vocation. That's what we're going to be praying for today. When we pray for vocations, that's what we're doing. Yes, clergy are there too, because we need shepherds. But there's so much more when we say that today is Vocation Sunday. So that's it. Turn to you.
Jane, I'm thinking about you and the big changes you've made. Huge changes and kind of pulled your stripes up as much as I know. Got your own place here, and new spring here, and can't even imagine all that you've done that you do it and come here and start with it. It's second reading, where it talks about of being children of God. Just struck me so much. And when Jesus talks about God and as his Father, he uses the term Abba, which in Jewish culture, that means daddy. And I knew that in my head, I knew that. But I was one time on vacation and I was in a pool and there were a lot of Jewish families there. And these kids are in the pool and they're squealing and squealing with delight to their Abba, who's playing with them in the pool. And the kids say, Abba, Abba, Abba. And suddenly really hit me on how intimate the child God is. And anybody who's had children knows how much we love our children. And to think that I'm a big child of God, and God loves me with that same intense love that I have for my children, just boggles the mind and warms the heart.
The piece of that, the piece of that Abba or Father that I love, and I guess I was lucky enough to have a dad who taught this to me, but there's so much trust in that person, and there's so much a sense of being protected, to know that you kind of can go on from there. It lets you be a springboard, because someone's got your back, to know, just always on your back, always is there, if you can, just is looking to make sure you're okay, so you kind of go and do your thing, you know, kids in the pool. But what if they weren't that protected, they wouldn't be that free.
And if you haven't had that experience, you'll be seeking another Abba in your life. And usually you will find an Abba where you will feel that comfort and that love. Because maybe your biological one did not give it to you. But you are always seeking it. Just as us, as we are, as children of God.
The lost sheep reminds me a lot of now with schools, and there's so many troubled people, and it's really sad. And the film festival had a lot of very inspiring movies, and one of them that wasn't about young people, but it was called Great Society, it was about old people. and it was about voting and how there's a lot of apathy, and it's not a happy thing, and it's not a good thing. And it was about this, a documentary about this Chicago project in the Miami-Dade area, and they had like 7,000 to 8,000 residents, and it shows how these people always have a giant swing in the political, who gets elected, and because they really care, everybody works on it. And there's people there, there was this lady, there was two key characters, and it was a documentary, but one of them was named Rose, and she was a 98-year-old woman that didn't really see, and didn't hear very well, and she was walking on her walker frequently to go to these political meetings, and to go vote, and to do different things, and her sister, her younger sister is 94. And she plays the piano beautifully. And you know, but they're all this whole community is, you know, just fired up, you know, and they talk about how they really worked to try to get Charlie Crist elected. Sadly, it didn't work. But it wasn't because they didn't try. And I thought, well, if 90-some-8-year-old people can do stuff, you know, it should really show us that we're not, in my estimation, clearly doing enough. Because they were citing things like maybe 30-some% of the people voting for the governor, and that is kind of sad. Mm-hmm. So it's sort of like, in my estimation, you get what you get if you don't really...
Correct.
And you can complain, but so I don't want to just be politically... Because it's firing. It's firing.
We can never be apathetic about our faith. Because Jesus and God, our Abba, is never apathetic with us. Always. Anything else? Okay, this is where we're going to have a slight switch. You should have a couple of papers within the select. One is a little sliver,
and one is a bigger.
And the bigger one says renewal of commitment to service. And we're going to do that today instead of the creed. And at the prayers of the faithful, we will end up the prayers of the faithful by saying the prayer for vocation. So whoever, I didn't put anybody's name, just somebody take parish rep 1, 2, 3, 4, and go for it.
I'll do one.
Go.
Father Jeff, today we celebrate Jesus as the Good Shepherd, who watches and guides the flock entrusted to him. At your ordination to priesthood, Jesus Christ shared his call to the priestly service of his church. Now, in the presence of your flock here present and those watching via Facebook Live and YouTube, are you ready to renew your own dedication to your parish and flock as a priest of Jesus' new covenant?
I am.
At your ordination, you accepted responsibilities of priesthood out of love for the Lord Jesus and his church. Are you resolved to unite yourself more closely to Christ and to try to become more like him by joyfully sacrificing your own pleasure and ambition to bring his peace and love to the brothers and sisters of St. Dorothy Catholic Community and of Greater Orlando?
I am.
Are you resolved to be a faithful minister of the mysteries of God, to celebrate the Eucharist and the other liturgical services with sincere devotion? Are you resolved to imitate Jesus Christ, the head and shepherd of the church, by teaching the Christian faith without thinking of your own profit, but solely for the well-being of the people you are sent to serve?
I will.
My brothers and sisters, pray for Father Jim. Ask the Lord to bless him with the fullness of his love, to help him be a faithful minister of Christ the High Priest, so that he will be able to lead this parish and all he needs out there to Jesus, the fountain of your salvation.
Lord Jesus Christ, hear us and answer our prayer.
We pray also for all of us, the flock of St. Dorothy Catholic Community, that despite our own unworthiness, we may faithfully fulfill the office of an ambassador of the gospel which Jesus Christ entrusted to us. Pray that we may become more like our High Priest and Good Shepherd, the teacher and servant of all, and so to be a genuine sign of Christ's loving presence among all.
Lord Jesus Christ, hear us and answer our prayer.
May the Lord in his love keep you close to him always, and may Jesus bring all of us, priests and ambassadors, to eternal life.
Amen.
We are saved in the name of Jesus, our Good Shepherd, who is alive and prays for us to Abba. Let us say to him, Jesus, keep us in your love. For the ministers of the church, that they may care for those entrusted to them with unselfish dedication, we pray.
Jesus, keep us in your love.
For the leaders of nations and all public servants, that they may place the interests of those entrusted to them above private gain and their own comfort, let us pray. For all Christian churches, that they work untiringly to become one under the one Shepherd, Jesus, let us pray.
Jesus, keep us in your love.
For those who do not yet know Christ, that they may encounter him and hear his voice through the ambassadors and other people who make Christ visible by the way they live, let us pray.
Jesus, keep us in your love.
For those abandoned by others, for victims of injustice and poverty, and for all others who suffer, that they may encounter dedicated people who give them hope and leadership, let us pray.
Jesus, keep us in your love.
For all our Christian communities, that we may live as we believe and make the gospel credible in our time, tough that it may be, let us pray.
Jesus, keep us in your love.
For all those that are sick in our parish, for Marion who had injured her shoulder, for Carol, for Joe, and I'm going to ask you to pray for me as I'm having surgery on Tuesday, that the eternal physician will watch over us all. We pray.
Jesus, keep us in your love.
And what other intentions do we bring?
So my sister Marissa Gomez Alberti, she was admitted to the hospital last week with heart complications. We all thought that she possibly suffered a heart attack, but lo and behold, she did not, but she still has complications in her heart. She'll be put on a heart monitor this week. Also, for the family and friends of Tim Bergling, also known as Avicii, who passed away this week.
Jesus, keep us in your love.
A little safe journey for those who travel as I depart on Saturday.
Jesus, keep us in your love.
And we'll add to that that New England will finally get some spring. No snow.
For my brother, who's on a mission in Guatemala, and for a dad who recently found out that he has bone cancer, and for his family.
Jesus, keep us in your love.
I have to pray for my church store, work co-workers, usually a lot of them have a lot of ailments, and they have a few issues last week. and as an older American, I'm sadly continuing to have issues. So I pray that your help is good.
Jesus, be blessed.
All the intentions you hold deep in the silence of your heart, and all those that are on our parish's website, we pray. And if together we can say the little prayer on the script. Jesus, you are the good shepherd. You know each of us, and you call us by name to all in the faith. Help us to respond generously to your voice. Give courage and guidance to those you call in the National Catholic Church, in the roles of priesthood, diaconate, religious life, and lay ministry as ambassadors of the gospel, so that they may respond wholeheartedly and serve devotedly. We ask this through Christ.